welcome back to the show. Freedom Agenda is an organization that's advocating for the decarceration and for investments in communities that are too often disrupted by systems of punishment. And as well, the organization is now centered on transforming communities historically disrupted by systems of racism through policy shifting, public education, and direct action. Join me now to share more details. We are pleased to be joined by the co-director of Freedom Agenda, Darren Mack. And Darren, good to have you.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, when Darren meets Darren, it's a good thing. Let me go right at it and talk a little bit about decarceration, because obviously we know that a big challenge across our country is mass incarceration. And the work that you're doing is really looking at how we can really make things better. So share with us a little bit about the mission of the organization.
Yes, so our organization is dedicated to decarceration in New York City. And you know, survivors of Rikers Island, like myself, have been fighting and advocating and organizing for years to reduce not only the footprint of jails across the city, but also the population size. So in 2019, City Council passed legislation to move forward with closing all 10 jails on Rikers Island, including the boat, and just having four borough-based facilities in the city. So that's going from 14 jails across the city down to just four. Currently, right now, we have about 15,000 beds across the city in our New York City jail system, and the plan will reduce that by at least by half to a maximum population of 3,300. This is a plan that's been on the table. This is a plan that this current mayor have been moving forward with, and we hoping to work with the next incoming mayor to move forward with that plan as well.
When we look at Rikers Island in particular, we know that the calls for the closure of Rikers Island are imminent. We see yet and still more incidents to continue to develop there. Are you optimistic that that Rikers will see that the doors close, and are you confident that the next mayoral administration will take it in that direction?
Yes, you know, the next incoming mayor has stated, you know, in public, you know, and, you know, that basically the closure of Rikers Island, that it needs to close. He stated that, you know, he supports the borough-based plan, and we're going to hold them to that. And as advocates and organizers, we push and pull elected officials to keep their word. So we're willing to work with the incoming mayor and his administration to keep their word. But right now, as you mentioned, the crisis that's happening in New York City jail system, with 16 people losing their lives and so many more harming themselves, so many more not getting the medical care attention that they need, we need to really take emergency action to address this human rights crisis, to deal with the situation that we currently have. And we're calling on this administration to work with the next administration to decarcerate now.
Yeah. Have you taken a look at the COVID-19 statistics and seen how incarceration has played out throughout the course of COVID-19? Are we seeing more people become incarcerated? Because I hear conflicting reports. Some people say the data shows that there were less arrests and less incarceration. We've heard on the other side that there have been more arrests and more incarceration. From your perspective, give us your take.
This past year, there has been, since the COVID releases, the population was actually dropped to about 3,800 people detained in New York City jail system. And then there was an uptick during the summer to about almost like 5,800. But right now, we're seeing the downtick once again that's happening. So the population in New York City jail system is about 5,400. And this is, like, you know, one of the things that we've been pushing, because there has been alarms about the resurgence of COVID within the New York City jail system. As we know, there's a new variant, you know, in the country. And so one way that we could deal with that, to flatten the curve for people getting infected, is to address this crisis by decarceration.
Mm-hmm. And so in your own ideal way, how would you see this process playing out?
Yeah, so there's many things that can happen. Like, for one, there's a successful program called the 6A Early Release Program that actually has supervised release for people who either serve city-year sentences. That could be expanded to more people, DAs and judges. You know, Unfortunately, DAs and judges have been requesting not bail, but basically ransom on people. You know, who we know that most people incarcerated in our system are not wealthy. They're black and brown, come from low income and poor communities. So who has $50,000, $100,000, $1 million just lying around for bail? So there's, you know, there has been bail reform, but unfortunately judges haven't been assessing people's ability to pay bail and unfortunately putting ransoms on people, because it's not a bail if you set $1 million bail on somebody that don't have $2. It's a ransom. So eliminating that, you know, and letting people out and letting people, you know, it's been plenty of evidence where people have been released and just return, go back to the community, go back to work, go back home and return to court. So I think DAs and judges need to like really evaluate what they're doing, because basically sending people to Rikers Island right now is a death sentence.
Yeah. And we know that we've heard the stories, of course, most notably Khalif Browder among so many, and then a recent another incident right there. What has been your response in terms of hearing from elected officials, dealing with elected officials when it comes to the issue of Rikers? You have many that say that they're on board, and I've talked with some and they say that, you know, there's still some things they want to weigh out.
Many city council members and incoming city council members have been clear that one, Rikers needs to close. But to address this crisis right now, those elected officials who are in office, they have to push this mayor to pull all the levers that we can pull to decarcerate. Work with grass-based organizations like Exodus Transitional Service, like Bronx Connect, like the Cure Violence, and to stop the feeding the pipeline, you know, into the system. There's been a lot of sexual programs that have been working that need to be resourced even more to stop the pipeline to prison and to help people on their reentry back into our community safely so they can return back to their court. Because people need to remember that the majority of people in our New York City jail system have not been convicted of crime. They're there because they can't pay bail.
Right. And I think that's a major issue to talk about, that you have people who are under the guise of the law, innocent until proven guilty, and yet and still they cannot simply pay bail. But it almost feels as though that by the fact that they can't pay bail, that guilty is the charge that they've been dealt with. So where do we go from here, and how do you see things playing out with your organization? I know that you're strong in the area of advocacy for policy changes and also the reuse of Rikers Island and other jail facilities.
Yeah, so from here, the first steps to all elected officials, all grassroots organizations, to one, decarcerate. Pull all the levers that we need to decarcerate. Expand the 6-8 program. Judges and DAs really evaluate people's ability to pay. And then, you know, if you're going to set a bail, set that, you know, so those two things, along with working with organizations on the ground that's serving some of the most challenged and historically under-resourced communities, we need a city budget that's going to be addressing the roots of criminalization and incarceration in our community. Because we're not going to end mass incarceration until we make mass investments. So hopefully this month, those recommendations will be published by the Commission of Community Reinvestments impacted by Rikers Island. And we hope that the next incoming mayor take those recommendations seriously so we can move forward with the closure of Rikers Island, with healthy communities, and with a society that could remove the stain that we have.
Yeah, Darren, you spoke a few seconds ago about the 6-8 program. Please make our viewers a little bit more aware of what the 6-8 program calls for.
Yeah, so the 6-8 program is an early release program for people who basically like have city sentences of a year or less. Currently, there's like probably about a little over 100 people right now who have could apply to this program and get in. And then there's other avenues, you know, ways that we could actually start reducing this population about 2,000 people with just like opening up different programs, open up, you know, sending people to, you know, transition into housing. Because a lot of times, sending people to therapeutic settings instead, because there's a high number of people inside our New York City jail system who have serious mental health issues. They shouldn't be in jail. They should be in a therapeutic setting setting in order to address their mental health crisis. So pulling all those levers to get people out of the human rights crisis that Rikers is now, because it's the longer that we keep Rikers Island open, the inevitability that someone was another person is going to die.
Are you optimistic in 2022 that we will see decarceration? Obviously, we know that we're still navigating this COVID-19 pandemic, and a lot of things are on the agenda for legislative matters. But when it comes to this, we know that this was something that's occurred before, but and has been dealt with before. But a lot of stuff has also experienced delays and also being put on the back burner. But when we talk about decarceration altogether, it's got to be a priority, if you will, for a new administration coming in, if we're going to see this thing happen swiftly.
Absolutely. I totally agree, because even the mayor's chief medical officer that oversees the New York City jail system, he's been calling for decarceration. Even the Board of Corrections, which is an independent body that oversees the Department of Corrections, has been calling for decarceration. Advocates, public defenders, been calling for decarceration. And the mayor, unfortunately, has been not listening to other. The only person he's been listening to is the outgoing police commissioner, who's been lying to the public, spreading fear about, you know, about bail reform, and that it has a connection to an uptick that occurred in the summer of crime, where there's no evidence at all, for bail reform having a connection to the uptick of crime during the summer. And in fact, the mayor hasn't really called his police commissioner out, but you know, he's outgoing. The public has started to realize that bail reform need to be implemented, that we can't decarcerate safely, and crime is still going down in New York City, but you know, there's a lot of work that needs to be done. I'll end it with that.
Yeah, are you optimistic, given the fact that we are going to see a new mayoral administration? Eric Adams will be taking over, and then also his appointment of a new police commissioner, a woman of color. How do you feel about that?
Optimistic is the word that I would utilize. I would say that, because no matter who's the mayor, no matter who's the commissioner, we're going to do as advocates and organizers have been doing since for the last several years, is to continue to advocate for decarceration, to continue to advocate for the closure of Rikers Island, to address conditions of confinement with the borough-based plan. And, you know, if we have to push and pull, then we're going to do that. If we have, you know, and the public, New Yorkers, you know, I believe New Yorkers believe in justice and fairness. And the plan that's on the table currently right now is a plan that can move towards that, and with a specific deadline. And the incoming mayor had expressed, you know, support of closure and moving forward the borough-based plan, and we're going to hold them to that.
Well, before we go, I want to have the opportunity to let our viewers find ways to be connected to you, to if they want to support the work and the advocacy that you're doing, how they go about doing that.
Yes, yeah, so you can actually email me at dmac@urbanjustice.org. You could go to our website, that's fa.urbanjustice.org. And or you can go to our social media, which is at Freedom Agenda NY.
All right. So, Dan, I want to thank you for being with us and sharing a little bit about the work that's going on. Certainly a lot of great work. We're going to hear about decarceration a lot in the year 2022. I know their advocates are calling for it. I know the mayor is going to have to confront it. And the question is whether or not we're going to actually see it. Darren Mack, thank you so much for being with us and sharing with us here on the Social Justice Forums.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right, we're taking a quick break, but guess what? We got more show. Don't go anywhere. The Social Justice Forums continues right after this.